We purchased our used CPO Tesla Model S 85D on May 10th, 2019. So we have just now hit our 5-year anniversary of ownership. It's simultaneously hard to believe that we've owned it for 5 years, and yet it's hard to remember life with the normal internal combustion engine or ICE vehicles that we owned prior. I made a video about our purchase experience, and I will put a card above to that video. And now, 5 years later, I still have never purchased a physical thing on this earth that was this much better than alternative options than our Model S. Of course, my high opinion of it has been buoyed up by the free unlimited supercharging at superchargers, as well as the free charging here at home from our solar panels that have now completely paid for themselves, which I made a video about previously that I will also link to in a card above. Despite free power, we have had to spend some money on maintenance and repairs, and I've made annual maintenance cost videos every year since we purchased our Model S. So I'm not going to go over the first 4 years of ownership, but I will link a playlist in a card above to all those prior videos. As of the end of May 9th, 2024, right at the end of the 5-year mark of ownership, our Model S had 138,904 miles on it. When we purchased it, there were 63,793 miles on it. That means we've put 75,111 miles on it. Now, those of you who follow my channel know that just 5 months ago, in early December 2023, we purchased a Model Y 7-seat long range that we transferred our free unlimited supercharging to. So due to that, our Model S is no longer our road trip vehicle. Our Model Y has been serving great as our new road trip vehicle, and we just got back from a 7,168 mile road trip to Key West, Florida from Utah in our Model Y. And as soon as I can get that trip edited, I will be publishing a video series of that trip. That being said, the Model S is now our daily driver around town, so we're still using it regularly as well as the Model Y here and there as needed. Because of that, we only put 11,306 miles on our Model S over the last year. Our Model Y just got to 10,000 miles on the odometer, and some people might say those 10,000 miles would have been put onto the Model S if we didn't have the Model Y. But we wouldn't have attempted the Key West, Florida trip with the S because the supercharging speeds were just getting too slow. In any case, I will be making a similar ownership costs video to this one for the Model Y on its 1-year ownership anniversary this December. One more thing before I get into the ownership costs for the last year. Because we now have two cars to drive around, and I'm ignoring the gas-guzzling truck, which we only drive when we're pulling the trailer around because its operational costs are way higher than either of our Teslas, I'm trying an experiment with our Model S. Starting March 3rd, 2024, I stopped charging our S from our house, and I exclusively charge it from the 2,650 watts of solar panels installed on the roof of our travel trailer. That solar energy is a use it or lose it situation, meaning if the RV battery bank fills up, then the solar panels stop producing any electricity since it's an off-grid system. Whereas our house solar panels always produce everything they're capable of, and the excess kilowatt hours accrue into our net metering balance for us to use anytime over the next year, up to early March each year. Every day, I charge our Model S from the trailer, and I adjust the number of amps that the S is pulling from the trailer via the Tesla app, and the trailer battery acts as a buffer between what the solar panels are producing and what the Tesla is pulling from the trailer. And I check on it periodically throughout the day.
As an example here in the Tesla app, the Model S is charging and it's at 5 amps, and so I'm going to increase that to 6 amps and then to 7 amps. You can see I can go all the way up to 20 amps is what the trailer will support, and then the Tesla starts pulling that amount of energy. And then up here in the Victron monitoring portal, I can see exactly what the solar is. That's this PV output right here, and I can see the AC loads, and that's what's going to the Tesla. And then over here is the state of charge of the battery in the trailer, which right now perfectly is just breaking even with the Tesla pulling 9 amps. And so that's about 2 kilowatts. And then as the weather changes, the solar yield gets higher in the middle of the day, which it is right now, and reduces. I'll come in here and periodically, depending on where the state of charge of the battery of the trailer is, if it's trending low, then I'll lower the amps and let it charge back up a little bit. Or if it's trending high, then I'll increase the amps on the car to bring it back down to roughly 40%. And if we're going to be using the car fairly soon and we're maybe going to be gone for a while, then I will actually increase the amps on the Tesla, straight up to the maximum of 20 amps to reduce the trailer percentage as quickly as possible because we're about to leave. And, sometimes I don't know that Jessica is about to leave and it's okay. If the trailer battery gets up to, say, 98%, and I'm at home, then I will go plug it into the Model Y just to make sure that the trailer doesn't fill up the battery. But generally, I'm trying to make all of the energy go into the Model S.
If we put more miles on the S than the travel trailer can supply, then we drive the Y instead until the S has charged enough to drive again. We stop driving the S when the battery gets down to a minimum of around 20 or 30% and then let it charge up from the trailer, then resume driving it when it's roughly above 40%. Although that mostly just depends on how long of a drive we need it for at any given moment. I've already made a video outlining more detail about how I charge my Tesla from our travel trailer's solar electrical system, which I will link to in a card above. But I bring it up here because I've begun this experiment of exclusively charging the Model S from our trailer alone out of curiosity to see what will happen. I already know from the last 2 years of charging the S from the trailer that roughly from March through October, the trailer solar panels produce enough energy for our daily driving needs, but it's the longer drives that we do randomly that threw off the balance before and required us to charge from the house sometimes. Now we drive our Model Y for all the longer trips, unless the S battery is getting full, which does happen in the few months on either side of the summer solstice when the power production is the highest. The winter is the main limitation to this experiment, so I'm not going to promise that we'll never charge from the house, but I will report back in a future video on the results of my experiment as I tried to go as long as possible without charging our Model S from the house. I recommend subscribing to get automatically notified when I publish that video. Now let's get into the maintenance costs for the last year. Throughout our ownership of this vehicle, I've kept this spreadsheet documenting literally everything that has been done to the Model S, whether it was covered under warranty, or free, or I did it myself, or I paid someone else to do the work. As you can see, there's only two line items for the last year: rotating the tires and a new cabin air filter that I realized while I was making last year's maintenance cost video that I should replace. That's all, and thanks for watching. No, I'm kidding. There's a little bit more nuance and detail to elaborate on here. Even though I didn't replace the wipers in this last year, I did want to follow up a little bit with them since I had just barely replaced them prior to the last video. The prior wipers from Bosch I installed November 2019, so they lasted 3.5 years before I somewhat subjectively decided that their performance had degraded enough to replace them. These new wipers I got from Costco, and their design was way inferior, and during the first rain I drove through, the driver's side wiper just flew off and immediately got crushed by traffic. I went ahead and got another of that wiper and tested it only to have it fly off again, and yes, I was using the appropriate adapters it comes with. Those adapters just don't fit well with the Model S, and I ended up smashing a sprinkler filter I had laying around to make it stay firmly, and it's been that way for the last year now. Next time I replace the wipers, I'm going to go back to the Bosch wipers that are much lower profile and fit better. The tire rotation is a free service I go to my local discount tire shop for because that's where I purchase my tires from, and I want them to have it on their records that the tires were rotated regularly so that I get my full mileage warranty on the next set of tires. In case you didn't know, if you installed tires at a discount tire or other tire shops that have a mileage warranty and have those tires rotated per their recommendations, which they do for free, then when those tires wear down to between 3 and 4:30 seconds, and keep in mind the mileage warranty is void at 2:30 seconds and below, so take action at 3 to 4:30 seconds, you purchase a new set of tires, and depending on how many miles you got on the worn out tires, Discount Tire will run the calculation and reduce the price of your new set of tires correspondingly. I'm not sure what the calculation is, but the general principle is if the warranty was for 60,000 miles, but you only got 30,000 miles out of them, they will look at what you paid for the tires and reduce the price by half and pay the difference towards your next set of tires, which can be completely different tires from a different manufacturer. In my case, I used to replace my tires just about every year, and this mileage warranty has saved me a lot of money through the years. The tires I'm running are the Michelin Cross Climate 2 tires that I purchased on June 1st, 2022, nearly 2 years ago, and they now have 20,916 miles on them. And at the last tire rotation, they were measuring at 6 and 7:30 seconds. They started at 10:30 seconds, so they're now at about half their tread depth, and thus are trending towards 40,000 miles at this rate, and 4 years. I'm also very happy with their performance in snow or rain, as well as dry roads, and I leave them on year-round. I haven't found there to be much of any reduction of efficiency either, although I've heard others report a small reduction in efficiency compared to the highest efficiency tires on the market. In any case, I'm very happy with them, and unless something changes, I will be putting on the exact same make and model of tire for the first time in owning the Model S. Then moving on, there's the cabin air filter. This is a super easy thing to do in our Model S. It only takes me 2 to 3 minutes to do it, and I get the filters from around $18 on Amazon, so there's not much to talk about here. And as you can see in my spreadsheet, that's everything in the last year, right? Well, not so fast. In prior years, when our Model S was still under the bumper-to-bumper warranty, I would quickly report anything that went amiss, and Tesla was great at replacing that part at no questions asked. However, as of May 2021, we haven't had the bumper-to-bumper warranty, so I'm now motivated to either fix it myself, or perhaps not worry about it if it's a minor thing. This is now getting into a gray area where some people might have promptly had these things fixed, and if they were making this video, they would have had them listed as a line item and how much it cost them to repair. Well, in my case, I haven't needed to get them repaired yet, so I'm just going to speak to them and I'll report in future videos what happens. First off, in no particular order, the driver's side tail light has poor sealing design. I say that with some degree of confidence because I had the light replaced under warranty back in June 2019, right after we bought the car, because it was getting dust inside. Well, it's now showing minimal signs of dust inside. I honestly can't tell unless I've washed the car, and unfortunately for our Model S, it's mostly parked outside now and thus not terribly clean most of the time. And I'm certainly not going to pay to get the taillight replaced just because I can see signs of some dust inside. Secondly, another weakness in the Model S is the steering column. In April 2021, Tesla replaced the intermediate lower steering link shaft because the steering had developed a behavior where every 90 degrees of turning the steering wheel, it would bind for a couple of degrees, then get easy again until the next 90 degrees, all the way around lock to lock. I had read about this back then and since, and others experienced this problem, and Tesla's solution is always to just replace that part. I don't know what they charge since I had it done under warranty. Well, I'm ticked at the prospect of replacing this part every 2 to 3 years. This problem started to manifest for us in December 2023, right after we purchased our Model Y. I did a little bit more research on it and considered buying the part and just replacing it myself, but I decided to take the frunk apart first to investigate the condition of it and see how hard it would be to get to myself. During that investigation, I found that it was very difficult to get to from the frunk area, and I saw in another YouTube video that some people remove the front driver's side tire to more easily access it. Conveniently, our coach sent me their jack pads, which I used with my floor jack and was easily able to get the front tire off to reach the steering shaft. If you ever plan to jack up your Tesla, I recommend jack pads like these to better ensure your jack and Tesla stay locked together to not damage the battery pack by jacking in the wrong location. I'll include a link in the video description below to these jack pads, and if you use the discount code ETA20, you'll get 20% off anything in their store, such as these mud flaps, which I will be including a review of in a future video. But in short, they have worked great on our Model Y, and they were really easy to install. Anyway, back to the steering shaft problem in the Model S. When troubleshooting, it's often a good idea to try the easiest thing first, if possible. So,
in an attempt to get to the steering column, I took out the frunk, thinking maybe I'll be able to see some parts of it here, which I can, but it's pretty minimal. So if I come down over this way and zoom in, you'll see that that is what I'm looking for right there. That vertical shaft coming out of there. But I need to get to a part of it that's farther back, and clearly I cannot access it from this area. So
if I come around over this way and look from up here, I can actually see a part of the steering shaft. And that's the top part of it right there. And then right there is a bolt that I believe is the top of the lower shaft. And then it goes down from there through this section and down below. And from down in here, I can barely see it, but it's hard to get on camera. Needless to say, it's not very accessible from up here.
I've now taken off the driver's side front wheel, and looking through this hole right here, really can't see it on the camera too well, but I should be able to see the steering column better, so I'm gonna keep investigating.
In this case, I could reach the steering shaft with the driver's tire removed, so I sprayed some of this CRC high performance lubricant with PTFE that I use on my RV slide out mechanism and any other light mechanical lubrication needs that I have. And after spraying this on all the parts I could see that move, I put the tire back on, and it's now been several months with no problems. Based on this experience, when the problem manifests again, I will likely just do the same thing rather than replace the steering shaft until lubricating it doesn't fix the problem. The next problem I've been having is with the charge port. It has begun to throw errors, and from what I can tell, the door position sensor has gone bad, so the car doesn't know if the charge port door is open or closed. Due to this, some of the behavior is it slams open and closes hard. it won't open by pressing on it anymore, and I have to open it from the app on my phone or on the center MCU screen. And there I have to press the unlock charge port door button specifically in order for it to open. Holding the trunk open button on the key fob also still works. Then, when the door does open, it takes a few seconds for it to lower the locking pin, which allows the charger to be inserted. Also, the ring of lights around it are not all showing anymore. It's been acting like this for 6 months now and hasn't progressed to any worse behavior, so at this point I'm just kind of waiting to see what's going to happen. But since it's still working, albeit less conveniently, I haven't bothered to get it replaced and I haven't looked into what that might cost either. If you know, feel free to chime in on what you paid in the comments below. And these are the only issues I'm having at the moment, and I will let you know in next year's video if there are any new developments on any of these outstanding issues. Before I end this video, let's look at the TeslaFi battery report to see how battery degradation is going. If you are not familiar with TeslaFi, it's an online service that connects to your Tesla account through the Tesla API and logs all kinds of information that Tesla does not provide that I find immensely helpful. So I have it tracking both my Model S and my Model Y. If you are interested in trying it out for yourself for a full month instead of the default of only a 2-week trial, then click on my referral link in the video description below. In TeslaFi, it keeps track of your charging and what your battery management system says the rated range is when the vehicle is charged above 90%. And when my Model S was brand new, it was rated for 270 miles of range. And now it is sitting at 245 miles. So that's a loss of 25 miles or 9.28% battery degradation at 138,904 miles on the odometer. I'm happy with this amount of battery degradation on a 9-year-old vehicle with nearly 130,000 miles on it. And at this rate, if we still have the car in 6 years, our kids are going to start getting their driver's licenses and it'll have plenty of range for their needs. When I sold my Nissan Leaf, it only had 45 miles of range, and the people who purchased it from me got it for their high schoolers to drive to school just a few miles away.
Here in the Tesla app, it has the charge stats screen, and you can see this is from June 2023 through May of 2024. Over that time, you can see there were a few months that we didn't supercharge it at all because we weren't taking the car on road trips. And then in December, that bar right here in the center, there's a lot of supercharging there because we drove down to Las Vegas to pick up our Model Y. And then that's when the supercharging was transferred over to the Model Y. And so immediately following, so January through May, there have been zero sessions at a supercharger. And we intend to continue doing that, meaning not using superchargers going forward. And then down here, you can see that it has estimated gas savings at about $1,992. I have switched over to the charge stats screen for the Model Y for that same time period, meaning this last year. And you'll see that, of course, December is when we purchased it, and there was some supercharging happening there, a little bit in January, and then February there was none. Because I was working on the Model Y in the garage, putting paint protection film on it and ceramic coating, and did not drive it at all that entire month. And it was just in the garage trying to keep it clean while I was working on that project. So that's why that is virtually zero energy consumption. And then starting in March and April, that's when we went on our Florida Keys trip. And so the amount of supercharging just skyrocketed for those 2 months. And then May so far, we haven't supercharged very much.
I hope this has been helpful, seeing how well our 9-year-old 2015 Tesla Model S 85D is holding up for us. And if you're interested in additional updates in the future on this car, as well as our 2023 Model Y, or trips in our Model Y, or our electric travel trailer, feel free to subscribe and change that notification bell to all to get notified of all our future videos. With that, thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.
Dad, it's about to start!
Lucy and I just unlocked the Cybertruck in the Beach Buggy racing game. Yeah. We finally have a Cybertruck, Lucy.
Yeah.
Oh, it's hard to steer when I'm looking at the phone.
Not hard for me. Sorry, guys.